thanks to WWF for organizing this and for the invitation. So I'll be talking about user genetics wildlife monitoring. As you all know, molecular genetics is one of the most rapidly advancing fields of science, and it's revolutionizing many aspects of our life. And also for monitoring wildlife, it's one of the most efficient tools we currently have at our disposal. Of course, it's not without its limitations, and some care must be taken on how we use it. So in today's talk, I'll first explain a little bit of background about approaches to genetic monitoring. I will show three example studies just to, you know, to provide some setting. And then we finish with some most common challenges we face in genetic monitoring and some recent advances that we've seen in the over the last years in methodologies. I'll not be comprehensive. This is, of course, a very broad field, and I'll try not to be too technical. Oops, just a sec. Okay. So what can we monitor using genetic tools? Maybe a quick overview of the topics. The most common thing we're interested in is probably population size and then related population dynamics. But of course, what we want to monitor will depend on specific requirements of each target population. We can understand genetics as almost like a Swiss Army knife, like a really this multi-purpose tool that we can apply to many, many different problems. And with genetics, we can get some insights that are often difficult or impossible to gain with other methods. Particularly, this rapid development is actually opening also new doors to new things. I will be talking today mostly about the stuff on the left, but I will be also, of course, there's many other things which I kind of listed on the right, which can also be studied with genetics. Some of them will be covered by the colleagues that come after me in their talks. When you talk about monitoring, we need to have the temporal component, meaning, you know, it has to have time. You know, it's if you just look at something once, it's not monitoring, it's just a survey. This means that studies should ideally be designed with this in mind from ground up. But important part is the data collection should be consistent and methods should be future-proof. I'll be talking about methods a bit at the end. But generally, you know, this quote-unquote formula formalizes the main idea of genetic monitoring. All animals leave their genetic trail in the environment, and we can follow this trail with molecular genetics. Now, we can use this to individually mark the animals. Once we find and genotype, for example, a scat or a hair of an animal, we'll be able to recognize this animal in any other sample from the same animal. But of course, genetic data from such samples can then be used also for other purposes beyond just individually marking the animals, to make other population level inferences. We're getting better and better at genotyping different material. We can get genotypes from scat, urine, saliva, hair, you know, eggshells when little birds hatch. In recent developments, even in snow tracks left in snow, for example. We call this type of samples non-invasive genetic samples, as there's no direct contact with the animal, but we can also sample dead animals when they die, or any live captured animals. It depends on the purpose and what we have available. And in parallel, our capabilities of analyzing these samples are getting more and more advanced, faster, cheaper, and more, what I think it's important, more and more routinized. It's becoming a routine. It's not, it used to be, you know, 20 years ago, this was cutting edge. Now, in many cases, it's not, you know, it's a standard method which is being applied as a routine service that benefits conservation. Okay, now I'll give some examples just to give us some setting. The first example will be a large study where we estimated population size of brown bears in two countries, in Slovenia and Croatia. We sampled a large area, 19,000 square kilometers, and we planned for a very short and very intensive sampling over 3 months to satisfy population closure, to be able to get a good estimate of population abundance. We used citizen science. So we got a lot of volunteers. We organized, this was a huge logistics challenge to mobilize all these people to actually be able to pull this off in this short time over this huge area. We ended up distributing 20,000 sampling tubes to the field, and we monitored sample collection in real time. And of course, there was a lot of communication, organization. So it was just from a logistic perspective, this was really, really big. The results were good. Within 3 months, we managed to collect close to 5,000 samples. We estimate, we don't know exactly, but we estimate there were over 2,500 people participating in the study. We used genotyping by next-generation sequencing to analyze the data, the samples, and we got quite decent genotyping success and detected 1,136 different animals. Then we applied marker capture modeling to this data to estimate the total population size. We did different modeling approaches and got nearly the same results. And for Slovenia, this was already the second study. We did first in 2007. And we saw 41.3% population growth. So this was quite important. In Slovenia, in this case, we can already start talking about genetic monitoring. It got the temporal component. In Croatia, this was the first survey. However, our period for monitoring is 8 years, and this last December we finished the sampling for the next season in both countries. So this is progressing further. Now, the next example is from wolf monitoring in Slovenia. This study was designed from ground up as long-term monitoring, where we estimate population size in each yearly session and estimate population dynamics between sessions. So it's a bit different than what we did with bears. Now, of course, we cannot disentangle mortality and emigration. The animals disappear. However, we can use genetics to reconstruct pedigrees and disentangle immigration and reproduction, actually the animals that were born in our country. It also allows us to recognize individual wolf packs and follow their social behavior. So maybe to look at the first 3 years of this, sampling was very intensive, so we got very precise population size estimates in every year. And the population size seemed to be slowly increasing throughout the study. However, we also observed huge mortality. We lost nearly half of the population each year. Large of this was detected mortality, like this is the dark red. However, many animals also disappeared. Some of the disappearances, of course, can be explained through dispersion. This is normal. Wolves leave their natal area when they grow up. But we also detected disappearances of reproductive animals. In this case, this must be mortality. So this is some of this is of course natural mortality, but also poaching is something that's not negligible in this case. But we also documented increases in the population, the recruitment. Some of this was through immigration, but interestingly, a large part of that was through reproduction. This is the dark green part. Was reproduction from the packs that we know. This is actually knowing the parents of the new animals, which show this high flexibility of a wolf population. We also observed similar high turnover, high dynamics in the population as we continued with the monitoring. The monitoring is going on. There was a little break when we ran out of funding from switching to live from live funds to national funding. And the population kept growing. It's now almost three times the size of of what it was when we started. The population seems the growth seems to follow the sigmoid population growth curve, which we expect from population ecology theory. And as the population expansion slowed down, also population growth slowed down. This trend is continuing. Now, the results of the last session, which is 22-23, are currently under review and will be published in a matter of weeks. But we see the same calming down of population growth as we can also see in this graph here. This last season is not shown in this graph. As I said, we also are able through pedigree reconstruction to track individual family groups, packs, which allows us to see how packs are distributed in space, see the social interactions, and also the status of certain packs. And we're also documenting the immigration from the alpine population, from other Dinaric subpopulations, and any cases of wolf-dog hybridization as an important conservation issue for this species. Okay, and the last example I'll show is a little bit different. It's about monitoring conservation status of a small reintroduced population of lynx in Dinaric Mountains. The population went extinct at the end of the 19th century, was reintroduced in 1973 from Slovakia. It was reintroduced only with six individuals, and the population is completely isolated from other lynx. And we started observing population decline, a worrying population decline in the early 2000s. There were many hypotheses what was happening with lynx, but through collection of historic samples, we were able to demonstrate how inbreeding was increasing in the population. Inbreeding, as you know, has, you know, as it increases, it can have severe effects on population fitness. And inbreeding in 2006 approached, you know, random breeding in the population approached brother sister mating in an, you know, in an outbred population. Lynx were suffering from genetic erosion through inbreeding. And this was probably the cause of the, you know, the obvious population decline. We showed that the population was edging into extinction vortex, heading into, you know, extinction. And basically these results, which we published, okay, I have the date wrong here, it was published in 2013. These results were critical to get political support for action. And we did act. We started a large population reinforcement project, Life Links, through life funds. We successfully translocated 16 animals from Slovakia and Romania, and we started a new stepping stone population in the Alps to facilitate connection between alpine and Dinaric lynx populations. Now, we're already observing the first results. The project is ending this year. Inbreeding is already decreasing, but the main effects, as you can see in this graph from a simulation study, are expected as the genes from the translocated animals are getting included in the population through reproduction. We're closely monitoring this with genetics. We made plans for long-term management of population. Of course, population is going to need further translocations. And through simulation studies, we kind of predicted what should happen with the population, but we'll be following closely this with genetic sampling and genetic monitoring. Okay. So this is, you know, just some examples of what we can do with this. Now, let's talk a little bit about specific challenges of genetic monitoring and some recent methodological advances. Now, when we think of genetic monitoring, we have three discrete components. The first two are laboratory and data analysis, and the second is field sampling. I would argue that the first part, you know, while it's challenging, things are largely controllable and predictable. You know, we can repeat things if things go wrong. This particularly becomes through as monitoring, you know, progresses and things become routine. From the end user perspective, you know, you need a reliable lab to do the work, reliable experts to analyze the data. The field sampling part is where the problems are. It's very unpredictable. Things can go severely wrong. And this is why I'm emphasizing this is that this is where focus should be. This is where what if you are thinking about a study like that, this is where you should really, really, concentrate and think about. Now, but let's go back to the main challenges we have with the lab. A main challenge when we work with non-invasive samples is sample, meaning DNA quality. Now, non-invasive genetic samples are typically bad, in the meaning the DNA in them is usually degraded or of low quantity. One of the effects is that not all samples will work. We get anywhere between below 40% success rates, and in some cases, up to almost 90%, which will depend on species, the method, field conditions, etc. And we need to take this into account when we design a study. The other problem that is critical from the laboratory and data analysis perspective are genotyping errors. When with bad DNA, genotyping errors cannot be avoided. They must be managed. And if the laboratory fails to do that correctly, this can have severe consequences for the results of the study. So, for example, if we use genotypes to identify individuals, then every error generates a new genotype, meaning a new shadow individual. If we don't handle this correctly, we can severely overestimate population size. On the flip side, if we overcompensate for errors, we can underestimate population size. So it's tricky. It must be handled very carefully. Now, a similar problem occurs if we want to do parentage assignments. The way to deal with both these problems is through repeating the analysis in what we call multiple tube approach. In our lab, we routinely repeat analysis of non-invasive samples 8 times, sometimes even more, to get the final consensus genotype. Now, this is critical. The second part is managing the remaining errors in downstream analysis and when identifying individuals or making pedigrees. And this must be taken into account and really handled carefully. So the first challenge is competent lab work. Laboratory must have experience in handling non-invasive genetic samples. That's critical. There are many genetic labs, but if non-invasive samples are new to them, they may get things wrong. So if you're considering such a study, the first thing you should ask is probably if they have a dedicated laboratory room for non-invasive samples. If they don't, they probably are not equipped to handle that. So now these things have been around for over 20 years, so it's not that much of an issue anymore, but it's still something that must be considered. The second challenge is data consistency. If we want to talk about monitoring, then the data 20 years down the road must be comparable with the data we're co collecting right now. So one of the most commonly used markers are microsatellites. They're hypervariable, meaning they have high information content, and they can be readily detected in non-invasive species, which makes them pretty decent markers. The problem with them is the serious disadvantage is the way they have been routinely or standardly analyzed, which is through capillary electrophoresis. This is plagued with some serious problems. The main one is subjective allele calling. So a genotype that you get will depend on the machine and on the person that's doing the genotyping. This makes data transferability between laboratories problematic, but also means that ensuring data consistency down the road is an issue. So, for example, if a technician changes or a machine changes, data needs to be recalibrated, and it's definitely not future-proof. A much better alternative is, which fixes pretty much all of these problems, is if we genotype microsatellites with high throughput sequencing. We get down to the level of DNA sequence in our genotyping, data becomes completely transferable and future-proof. The method is also very cost-effective and fast, can be scaled, for rapid analysis of large studies. The only drawback or current drawback is that if we have a small number of samples, it may be a problem to analyze them efficiently with this method. Another advance that's being more and more picked up also are SNPs. It's a single nucleotide polymorphisms, which is another, let's call it flavor or marker, Astrid after me is going to be talking more about them, but they can also be analyzed in non-invasive samples on Fluidigm platform. Data is also objective and comparable between labs. It's future-proof. They have high success rate, which is also one of the benefits of genotyping with sequencing of microsats. They're a bit more costly, and what I particularly don't like is the tied to proprietary technology to the Fluidigm platform, which makes their usage a little bit more tricky. One of the advances I think is important also is that now we're able, with combination of genetics, sorry, genomics and bioinformatics.
I would like to just 2 minutes. You need
I
to.
know, I'm
Okay,
getting close to the end.
thank you.
So we're able to rapidly and cost effectively develop new markers for basically any species, which is something, not all species are as well studied as wolves or bears. This gives us the possibility to really make new markers for a species that that is of conservation interest and would need genetic monitoring. And of course, genomics is opening new options for us in many ways. So maybe one of the last things to mention is that the main challenge still remains field sampling. The field sampling is often underestimated, and it always requires more effort and costs more than what we think. Try to involve a statistician, data analyst in planning, and really plan thoroughly. And don't underestimate it. For example, for a bear study we're doing right now, bear monitoring in Slovenia, the total costs are about half a million euros, and we're sampling with volunteers. And about half of that cost is the cost of field sampling, just organizing the field sampling. So don't underestimate that. There are some recent advances with how we sample the DNA, which makes it easier and more efficient, particularly if we work with volunteers, which can also increase success in such studies. So to sum up, there are some disadvantages to genetic monitoring, some difficulties, of course, we must face, but there are many advantages. And often, genetics is the only tool that will provide answers. So that's it for me. Thank you. Thanks again to the organizers for the invitation.